deadly hit-and-run crash involving two motorcycles.
His son opened fire on him.
After an unarmed African-American teenager was shot and killed.
I watched the elephant pick him up.
It was all caught on the family's home security camera.
On his dash cam.
This one is my favorite. The little piece of horror I hold closest to my heart. The blunt conclusion of life. There's a gargled quality to the man's desperate moaning that I like. As if he's failing to scream. One would expect a high level of gravitas from these moments. It's difficult for the Philistines of the world to picture death without a layer of glamorous Hollywood melancholy. Consciousness rarely fades, is often ripped away. Our grip isn't as firm as we know it to be. The ethereal feeling in my stomach begins to creep in now. The dragon I chase, my thrill. I can picture myself in that store. The lingering smell of gunpowder, the array of colourful products stacked neatly on the shelves. And him, a body floating between our world and what faces us beyond. I'd share the moment with him. I'd place my face near to his. I would feel the warmth of his last few agonal breaths. The subtle characteristics of his voice turned to a homogeneous sound of a soul escaping. An ugly, pleading roar that warms me. To be there, where all bodily functions are involuntary, is to be at the heart of humanity. What beats underneath the layers of personality, experience and emotions we all collect throughout our lives. What really makes us? I've watched these tapes over and over. I've introspected, studied my feelings, reactions, urges. I used to ponder at why I tingle at the sights I see. Am I sick? Overly macabre? Or does something dark lie within the recesses of my brain? When I was 11 years old, I remember walking down the snowy streets of Kensington with my mother. I remember the scream that cut through the pleasant atmosphere like a hot knife through butter. A guttural scream. Cars grind to a halt, tires screeched. We tracked closer towards the commotion. The screams became more deafening and desperate. Eventually I heard my mother gasp in shock. Before I could even react, she pressed her hands against my eyes, forming a crude blindfold with her fingers. As we walked on, I frantically tried to see past my own mother's flesh, prying my eyes through every slight gap. In doing so, I saw flashes of tragedy. A woman, in a fur coat, was the source of the screaming. I remember finding her willingness to destroy the extravagant clothing she was dressed in, with dark grey snow, rather unorthodox. I saw a pair of pink, flowery Wellington boots and a matching pink dress, and a thick pile of raspberry marmalade, exactly where her little head should have been. I should have felt shock, but I didn't. I felt indifference, even fascination. My days are spent in these tapes, ogling at lives far cheaper than my own.
rapists executed in lawless countries.
South Americans on CCTV. People ripped apart by wild animals, escaped from cages. A broody New York cop spilling the brains of an unarmed teenager. They conjure feelings in me that Bukowski and Tolstoy could only dream of replicating. An indescribable bittersweetness to which I owe a vast amount. Hence why my days of pondering over my habit are long behind me. If I was to find the source of the enjoyment, I run the risk of losing this unorthodox spark. I'm not a sick man, nor an overly psychotic one. Just a man with morbid sensibilities. A man with nothing else.